computer plan a city? You might be thinking, why not? Our devices are constantly sharing data about where we are and what we are doing. And through the apps we use, we already trust algorithms to tell us what to have for dinner or how to get to work. Consequently, we now have more data than ever before about how people are living in our cities, and hype about things like smart cities and digital innovation is through the roof, as is demand for my public speaking services as a scholar in this area. Surely, it would be easy, right? Well, let's rewind a second. It's the 1950s, the dawn of modern computing. With World War II now over, people begin to imagine how computers can be used in civilian life. Almost immediately, people begin thinking about how the immense powers of calculation that are offered by these new machines can be applied to the problem of planning a city. Surely, it would be easy, right? Well, with a growing population and unshakable faith in these new machines, people in the United States of America set out to plan Chicago's future transit network. Widespread adoption of the private automobile had seen the rapid expansion of the city in recent years into large, sprawling, low-density suburbs, a change which, as you can imagine, required massive reconfiguration of the city's highway and transit networks. In 1956, the Chicago Area Transportation Study employed over 350 people to do a travel survey of almost 50,000 households. Processing this data went on for several years. Whilst computers could relatively quickly calculate the likelihood that someone would want to get from one part of the city to another, the mainframe computers they had at the time had negligible digital storage space. This meant that the input data was entered using punch cards. The output was displayed using a cartographotron. And this was the device that would map out a mess of millions of white straight lines representing transport trips on a black photographic plate. Whilst they eventually did produce a plan, it took them over 7 years, and when all was said and done with such clunky outputs and such a cumbersome process required to produce them, large-scale urban modeling like this fell out of favor, at least in mainstream urban planning practice, for the next 50 years. That was so long ago, though. Surely it would be easy now, right? Well, to a certain extent, yes. It is now the present day. The population of Sydney is predicted to grow by over 1 million people in the next 20 years. Like Chicago back then, planners want to make sure that there is enough infrastructure to support this growth. Unlike Chicago back then, planners now realize that this unconstrained suburban development has not been good for the environment, and that it's also expensive to provide public transit services over such large and thinly populated areas. In order to address this problem, embedded within the plan is the concept of a 30-minute city. This is essentially a concept which says development should occur in places that are located within 30 minutes by public transport of everywhere the people living in those places would need to go on a daily basis. The people planning Sydney use an algorithm to map this out. They measure how long it takes to get from what is perhaps your house to the nearest major employment centre, and then the same for every house in the city. And because computers are really good now, instead of that mess of white lines, display the output in a colourful and interactive digital map, all within the course of a couple of hours. This analysis provides fundamentally useful information for urban planners. It quickly highlights areas where urban development should be allowed to occur and also areas where public transport needs to be improved. Although it will take a long time for the plan for Sydney to be realized, the plan describes a pattern of new urban development that is tightly focused around transit networks and train stations. It also sets in motion initiatives to improve the provision of public infrastructure in Western Sydney, an area of the city that is often neglected by planners and decision makers who tend to live in the East. Let's take a step back though. As useful as this algorithm has been, how does it count everywhere you need to go? And by what mode of transport and what time of day? In the first year of monitoring the plan, this was measured as the proportion of people living within 30 minutes of a metropolitan centre using a scheduled public transit service between the hours of 7 and 9 a.m. In the second year of monitoring the plan, 2020, this was measured as the proportion of people living within 30 minutes of a metropolitan centre or a strategic centre or even a large local centre between the hours of 6 and 10 a.m. And this is great, but what about all the other journeys that you make in a day? Think about perhaps picking your kids up from school or soccer training. What about those people that work night shifts at factories or construction sites or packing supermarket shelves? In this case, they are not counted. Now, the decisions made using this sort of evidence have a real impact on your quality of life and the opportunities that you have access to as a person living in the city. Over the past few years, there has been an explosion of guidance around how to ensure that individuals' data privacy is protected and that individuals are protected from unfair decisions made by artificial intelligence. However, there is very little guidance when it comes to decisions made on behalf of entire cities and communities. For all their limitations, algorithms provide us with a language unlike any other. They allow us to explicitly describe our understanding of the city in a way that can be perfectly replicated and improved by others if shared. However, there are currently no requirements for planners to publish their underlying data or algorithms. Though talking about data, I'm going to let you in on a secret. Despite everything I've told you so far, for those of us involved in planning your city, we rarely have up-to-date data on what the hell is going on. 10 years ago, I was given my first job as a student planner at my local council. In this job, I was employed throughout the entirety of summer to Google phone numbers for a business survey. Council had no more than a rough idea of the number and type of businesses in the city. In more recent years, since learning to code, I have been employed to write code to scrape websites for the same information. Councils still don't know. In recent years, there have been many private companies rushing in to sell data and analytics to government in order to try to fill this gap. We have telecommunications companies with mobile phone data and other companies that collate data from location sharing apps in order to analyze how people move around the city. We have Google Maps with its huge database of location and places. We have credit card companies that record the location and the amount of retail transactions that are made all around the city. And of course, real estate companies who have information on commercial leases and house sales. Most of this data, however, is very expensive in the realms of tens and hundreds and thousands of dollars. It also comes with very limited terms of use and cannot be shared more widely. This trend, however, sits awkwardly with the fact that planning is public purpose work. Planners make decisions with and on behalf of communities that in the medium to long term affect the lives of everyone in the city. They must therefore be able to understand the evidence they use and explain their decisions to the public. Instinctively, I think planners know this, and despite the potential for some of these datasets to be really useful, my research shows that their use in practice is yet to be widespread. I see a couple of ways that we can break this impasse through investment in public data and changes to policy. The first is we need more investment in more detailed and quality data that is open to all. My research shows that there are still a number of key datasets missing, including an adequately detailed digital dataset of the road network and a spatial register of individual development approvals and completions. The second would be to set standard terms of engagement with private providers of data and data analytics. Increasingly, in order to publish my academic work, I must share my underlying data as well as any code that I wrote to analyze it. I would like to see a similar standard set for our public bodies and anyone who works with them. Even if few people can use this raw material today, it will future-proof the work that is done and allow direct collaboration with organisations far beyond the often siloed walls of a government agency, even internationally. More importantly, however, as algorithms become more complex, we must redouble our efforts to communicate their use, including any assumptions in plain language that all can understand. So, in summary, could a computer plan a city? No. No, not even with substantial improvements to the technology we have today. Could an algorithm adequately capture the complexity, the messiness, the richness that is real life in the city? Could a computer help plan a city, though? And to this, I say yes, but only when those working with the algorithms and data show they're working and explain to us all how their decisions were made.